We're delighted to welcome you to the 14th Jaipur Literature Festival protected by Dettol straight from Diggy Palace. It's a pleasure to present today Innovation, Imagination and Creativity. Vinay Sahasrabuddhe, Mugdha Sinha, Shubhendra Rao and Roger Highfield in conversation with Sanjoy Roy. How do we understand culture? Does it stem from civilizational history or is an evolving way of life? How do we reinterpret and regenerate its roots? In a pandemic-ridden, constantly transforming world, how does innovation and creativity manifest in society and how can they be promoted despite the difficulties of our times? Rajya Sabha member Vinay Sahasrabuddhe is the president at the Indian Council for Cultural Relations and the director of the Public Policy Research Center. Mugdha Sinha is a secretary Art, Literature, Culture and Archaeology and secretary Science and Technology as well as the director general Johar Kala Kendra and the literary secretary of IS Association Rajasthan. Shubhendra Rao is a celebrated composer and sitar player. Roger Highfield is the science director of the Science Museum Group. Together, they discuss the fascinating interplay between culture, innovation, economies, and societal beliefs and delve on the roots of creative sustenance. Vinay Sahasrabuddhe is a nationalist social worker at heart, a researcher student of political science, and trainer in democracy by profession, and a parliamentarian by elevation. Since January 2018, he has been the president of Indian Council for Cultural Relations, ICCR, India's soft power promotion establishment. A member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha from Maharashtra, he is also chairman of the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Education. For 6 years, Dr. Sahasrabuddhe was also the national vice president of the Bharatiya Janata Party, India's principal ruling party. He has around half a dozen books in Marathi and English to his credit. Mugdha Sinha is a career civil servant with 20 years of wide-ranging experience in governance, policy making and international trade negotiations. She is currently Secretary Art, Literature, Culture and Archaeology and Director General Kala Kendra Jaipur for the Government of Rajasthan. Shubhendra Rao is an internationally acclaimed performer, composer, cultural entrepreneur and music educator. A protege of Bharat Ratna Pandit Ravi Shankar, he has established himself not only as a master of his instrument but also as a thinking musician. Together with his wife Saskia Rao, who has authored India's first ever music curriculum for children, Sangeet for All, they are transforming the way music is taught in Indian schools. Roger Highfield is the science director at the Science Museum Group. He is a member of the Medical Research Council, a fellow of the Academy of Medical Sciences and a visiting professor at UCL and Oxford. Sanjoy K. Roy, an entrepreneur of the arts, is the managing director of Timbuk Arts, which produces over 33 highly acclaimed performing arts, visual arts and literary festivals in 40 cities across the world, including the iconic annual Jaipur Literature Festival, international editions of JLF and the launch during lockdown digital JLF Brave New World series. He is a founder trustee of Salam Balak Trust, providing support services for street and working children in Delhi. Roy works closely with various industry bodies and the government on policy issues in the cultural sector in India and has lectured and collaborated with leading international universities. Ladies and gentlemen, Innovation, Imagination and Creativity. Vinay Sahasrabuddhe, Mugdha Sinha, Shubhendra Rao and Roger Highfield in conversation with Sanjoy K. Roy. Enjoy the conversation.
Absolutely delighted to welcome Roger Highfield, Mugdha Sinha, Shubhendra Rao and of course Dr. Vinay Sahasrabuddhe to this particularly timely session on creativity, innovation, and imagination. Of course, the even of the world came to a crashing halt in March of this year with the advent of the pandemic. March of last year with the advent of the pandemic. Everybody scrambled to see how they could be creative, whether it was baking new loaves of bread or reinventing themselves as artists or writing away. And of course, the innovation field, the very fact that we're being able to speak to you today, not on ground at the Jaipur Literature Festival, but through this particular online platform, is one of the innovations that have come about due to the pandemic. But before I go to any of the questions, I wanted to set the stage to some extent in terms of where we are and what is the difference between, or if any, between imagination, creativity, and of course, innovation. So dreams at night, for example, is a form of imaginative thinking. Imagination is about seeing the impossible or the unreal. Creativity is using imagination to unleash the potential of an existing idea in order to create new and valuable ones. And innovation really is about taking an existing reliable system or process or idea and improving on them to make it better and easier and more exciting? These are some of the issues that I hope we're going to be able to cover in this conversation. And I'm going to go straight to Roger Highfield, who has, what's always fascinated me about Roger is the fact that he bounced a neutron off a soap bubble. And I want to ask him, what was that? Part crazy, part creative? Which part of your brain comes to play here? Because as you know, Roger, one of the things that we're trying to do through the platforms like the Jaipur Literature Festival is break down this divide between, or this artificial divide between the arts and sciences. And we say that you need both. The argument that we want to give to educationists, and I'll come to Dr. Sesabudde in a second on that, is we need people to understand that you need both. You need a sense of the science and arts because the arts allows you to envision, the science allows you to make it possible. But Roger, bouncing a neutron off a soap bubble, seriously, what were you thinking?
Well, first of all, I should say, I totally agree that I hate the two cultures debate. You know, I think art and science are the sort of subjective and objective poles of the same, one same culture. They're different ways, different lenses to look at it. When it comes to me bouncing neutrons off soap bubbles, I was just carrying out the instructions of my supervisor, being just a humble doctoral student. But at the heart of it was something quite paradoxical. You know, we were interested in quantum theory. We knew that actually, even though neutrons are particles, they behave like waves. And just like when you see a slick of oil on a pond and you get those beautiful interference colors, so you can do the same things with neutrons. You can make neutrons interfere with each other. That's one of the consequences of so-called wave-particle duality. And I think you're right. Science is sort of interesting in that you've got a lot of constraints about how the world works, but then you need a lot of creativity to find ways to investigate it. So we used a nuclear reactor in France, for example, to do this sort of research. And I suppose the other thing about science and creativity is that, you know, there's a lot of interest in using brain scanners to look at what's going on in someone's mind when they're doing a creative task. So for example, with jazz improvisation, it's really interesting because you can see that when someone does improvisation, it's drawing on these two what seem to be opposite poles of the brain. There's something called the default network, which is most active when the mind is wandering, when you're daydreaming. And then there's the executive control network, which becomes more active when focused on a task. So you've got these two sort of opposites working together to help jazz improvisation. I could go on, Sanjoy, but I think I'll stop there.
So Roger, so one more quick question. What separates eccentricity from, say, creativity and imagination? You have Don Quixote sort of, launching his great epic sort of battle against the windmill. And here, for example, for those of you who don't know, if you go to Roger's wonderful office, he'll stand on his walker and your conversation will be Roger on the walker with you opposite Roger on the walker. Is there a sort of difference of practical creativity, which then with your imaginations makes it possible to be able to bring to fruition an idea?
I think a lot of scientists do find that when they let their minds wander a bit, that helps. You know, Andre Geim, who got the Nobel Prize for physics for inventing this or discovering this two-dimensional material graphene, he would create a kind of playful time in the laboratory, Friday night experiments, when he would muck about and do things like levitate, would you believe it, hamsters in a magnet, which did lead to some interesting science. So I think there's a bit of playfulness there, but equally you don't want to be so open-minded to ideas that your brains fall out. So I think it's a matter of getting, is creating opportunities to think more broadly, but also having that focus to pursue an idea to the nth degree.
Dr. Sasabudde, Roger talked about pursuing an idea to the nth degree. Now, everybody, the reputation that you come with, not just as an innovator, but an educationist, but also about getting a task done. The two questions that I have for you, Dr. Sasabudde, one is that, in the Indian education firmament, we don't put much stress on design and innovation. And if you want to do design, you have to do it after you finish school or college. Our education system is still, you have to teach what you're given. You're not that joy of learning, which allows you to discover and, you know, creates your brain in a way that functions and allows you to fly. That tends to be non-existent in our system. And yet you take those same people from the IITs and IIMs, or even young people who haven't had access to that kind of education. And I'll give you an example a little later. And you put them in a system, say you send them to America, to NASA, and they're able to create the most incredible inventions. Dr. Sarasubhadra, I want to ask you, how do you see this connection? And do you feel that it's absolutely vital, especially now, looking at India for the next 50 years, that we have to fix this education aspect, but not middle school or senior school or university, but really from day one, and have this idea of design, innovation, aesthetics, and the curiosity? How do you create curiosity? Dr. Sarasubhadra.
Yeah, I think what you are suggesting is absolutely right, and nobody can dispute with that. But let me also hasten to add that let us not rubbish everything that was there in our traditional system. Because as you know, many big corporate houses that are being now led by Indians in America, especially, and you can take any other name, he has been the product of our traditional Indian education system. Okay. For example, we by heart tables when we study mathematics. And that many people say that that has proved to be the basic foundation of their understanding of mathematics, maybe. So it's not everything that requires to be rubbish, but of course we have to evolve. Times are changing, and more element of creative thinking, more element of original kind of ideas coming up requires to be promoted. Unfortunately, what has happened during the last maybe couple of decades, while there are people who are innovators essentially, but we have been kind of indulging in name calling and in a way ridiculing their ideas as jugaad. But I believe maybe you must have come across a well-known scientist, Mashelkar. He is he takes exception to this description of jugaad. And we are much more than jugaad, and there is nothing wrong about jugaad as well, because ultimately it helps what the Prime Minister described, that ease of life. And therefore, all these things are interconnected. But I believe the new education policy that has been unveiled very recently talks about promoting all these faculties. And I'm sure we will have many more aspects of creative education. And as what you suggested, a more designed approach towards education coming into the play when the implementation of the policy happens.
No, you're totally right, Dr. Sarasubhadra. You know, I keep saying that jugaad, the way that we understand jugaad, Roger, in case you don't, and our viewers may not know, it seemed to be as make do. So if NASA, the spacecraft isn't going up, somebody will run up and, you know, tie two strings and the spacecraft could go up. But if you instead change it around and say that it's the way to make possible, meaning you're able to envision fairly simply and practically something that is, you know, a vision. So Dr. Sussman, coming back to you again, you know, we know that in India, innovation is at the fore. I mean, whether it's at the village level, at the district level, and this is not about people coming out from fancy schools with fancy grades. And I'll give you an example before I ask my question. You know, in MIT Media Lab, I'd gone to do, you know, because I have long hair, I get invited, as Roger knows, to give lectures all over. So I was at MIT Media Lab giving a lecture about the next big idea. And they were saying, so I said, why don't you have enough people from India as part of the MIT Media Lab development? And they said, oh, you know, we look for PhD students and it doesn't work for us and we've tried many. So I said, that's the wrong place to look. Why don't you do a workshop? Come to Pune, which is the hub of education in India, one of the hubs, come and do a series of workshops. So anyway, they came. They finally agreed. They sort of agreed. They came. They did a workshop. And one of the young people they chose was somebody who had failed or got F in 10 courses out of his 20. And I don't think did university, but he had a spark. So they called me and said, you know, what do you think? And, you know, it's your idea. So you have to agree. So I said, listen, you are only going to spend $75,000 a year on this person. So that's not even 0.001% of today's interest on this year's endowment that you've received. So kar lo. Now, this young person goes to MIT Media Lab. He's part of the seeing, the people who work with seeing challenged people. And they normally look at how do you better the stick or how do you better reading Braille. What did he do in his first 3 weeks? He put a chip in his left slipper and a chip in his right slipper, connected it to Google Maps. So when he had to turn left, the left slipper vibrated. When you turn right, the right slipper vibrated. So simple. So Dr. Sarasapathy, what do you think, you know, when we talk about innovation and we know that India is such a vibrant, culturally vibrant place, can you give us a context of culture, creativity, and therefore innovation?
Well, I think the pandemic offered us many opportunities to learn as to how do we evolve a kind of synthesis between all the three things that you are referring to. For example, there are people who chose to keep every other creative activity at the back burner. Some people also gave a full stop to that. But I know, for example, I come from Mumbai, and Mumbai has a very rich theater tradition. And there are many small amateurish kind of and even professional theater groups who continued with the pandemic as well. Multiple locations were converted into a integrated kind of stage to perform on it. And artists, somebody is from, maybe somebody is in Goregaon, somebody else is in Andheri, and somebody else is in maybe Churchgate. And all of these three characters were performing in their homes, within the four walls of their homes, residences. And it was through Zoom, for example, presented to the people, and it worked wonders. So the confidence that even in this time of pandemic, we will have to work with the show must go on spirit, and we cannot give a full stop. We will have to work. This has been evident in several ways, even in education for that matter. I know several stories where how teachers who were very passionate to continue with the education used open grounds in a village and used the microphone, and they were kind of a public lectures, and students were trying to attend their lectures, audit their classes while sitting in their homes as well, because it was not very easy to move out of homes in those days. So likewise, there are n number of examples where this passion has perhaps driven people to find out their own solutions. And therefore, I believe, especially when it comes to innovation, creativity, and imagination, I believe people have learned that it makes more sense to move from theory to practical, which takes you to some kind of a solution-centric kind of methodology to approach any particular, maybe a crisis situation or a difficult situation kind of. And in practically every other state, we conducted a hearing under the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Education to get to know as to how the instructional exercises have been still on at certain places. And for example, there are reports coming from Assam, even Jammu Kashmir for that matter, places like Pune or even Tamil Nadu, where people have wonderfully come out with ideas which could be some kind of a guideline for all of us to continue in a pandemic kind of a situation.
Thank you. Mukta Sinha, Dr. Sarasapathy talked about theory to practice. Like when you all join the bureaucracy, yes, you get a lot of training in terms of theory, but when you actually go into the field and you get posted, it's really your creativity. Every situation is new, I'm assuming. Tell us a little bit how you deal with the practicalities, the creativity, and the need for creative thinking in bringing about both imagination and, of course, innovation.
Thank you very much, Sanjoy, and a very, very warm welcome to all our fellow participants today. I think that's a very relevant question, and thank you for linking it with my own experiential living as part of my own career for the last years. See, the governments and the successful governments are the ones which can be. So So you spoke about design. Design, very, very important part of it, because our entire policy making exercise is based on the design architecture. And, you know, design architecture actually involves a whole lot of user experience. So, you know, when people from the outside see us holding meetings with our stakeholders, it becomes very, very important to understand, because the governments are all about problem solving, right? So we do these meetings to understand from the stakeholders what is it that is required. Because the job of the government in terms of policy making on one hand and implementation on the other, because the devil, of course, lies in the implementation, is to understand from the stakeholder what its expectations from the government is. And then through the policy making architecture or instrument like the Archimedes lever, provide a level playing field to be able to execute for everybody, for all the stakeholders, in a manner that it is acceptable and receptible by the public, for whom, because our end goal, you know, if you look at science, the goal of scientists is to do translational research so that they are able to solve a problem of society, right? The work of artists, especially in the COVID times that we have seen, is to provide sukha to the people. You know, how much ever you think art is inessential, but you realize that it becomes essential. It is almost like water. When you are choking over food, you need water and not beer or not any other kind of beverage. So that is how important art is. And currently, the COVID, you know, I found myself for the first time in my life at the right time, at the right place, because COVID was all about being able to use both the left and the right side of the brain, which basically means the coming together of the cognitive faculties through the science, the rationality of the left part of the brain, and the artistic faculty, which is the emotional side. So whether we were looking at labor migration, and I was in charge of all Maharashtra and looking at all the needs, their food, their comfort, so be it that, be it, you know, devising schemes for how we could support the artist in such difficult times. I think it was basically a coming together of everything. And, you know, all our knowledge cannot be bookish. In fact, all our knowledge, which is based on skill, has to be hands-on. And the beauty of a service is that it gives you that platform to be able to use your hands-on experience on an everyday basis and to translate it and put it in the service of society.
Roger, I'll come back to you with this hands-on experience. But Mukta, one other question. You know, you talked about process and design, and that's what, you know, governments, in the way you deliver a project, obviously, because you're not reaching, you know, 100 people, or especially in India, you have to reach out to millions and billions of people. Does process and design become an impediment in creativity and imagination? And how do you cross that bridge? And I'm going to ask Vineji this question as well, as to how he's been able to use that when he innovates. But Mukta, first you.
Yes, government service, one about exposure and facing this challenge. We are actually crisis managers. You know, so that is the skill, that is the job. You might be secretary of one department, you might be the district director of a province, but what you are doing on a daily basis is looking at the challenge, because as you yourself, that India is a huge country, we are a very, very country. So the challenges differ based on communities, based on the intersectionality of class, gender, religion, a whole kaleidoscope of issues brings about that challenge. You know, I feel that, you know, Mahatma Gandhi said something very, very important. He said that the means are as important as the ends. You know, the very fact that we are talking today of culture, we are talking of civilizations, process is very, very important. When the process does not enable us to come to outcomes that we require, I think we can change the process, you know, because change is the only constant thing. But when we don't review our policies, when we hold on to those policies and we know that policies are not yielding the right outcomes, then it becomes a problem. So the creativity lies in the fact that you look at a policy and see whether it's relevant today. See, look at the times that we have spent last year juggling with a whole lot of issues. And technology actually became the Archimedes lever, right? It enabled us to keep in touch despite the fact that we were all isolated and in lockdown. So people who were able to use this process of technology, we were able to through our e-office. So, you know, they launched everywhere in the country on the 25th of March. And right from 1st of April, the Department of Science and Technology was on its feet. Within 7 days, because it was also the end of the financial year closing, we were on our feet because we were prepared. Processes don't data. That, I think, is a myth, that is a fallacy. We are human beings who should constantly look at changing stuff which doesn't work. So review should become a very, very important mechanism. And I can tell you that the amount of flexibility that I have had in the government, working within the architecture of the rules and still being able to deliver, I think is all because we have to look at creative ways of doing things. I don't like this whole idea of, you know, thinking out of the box. And just to give you one example and rest my case with that, before Henry Ford actually was able to invent the motorized vehicle, you know, somebody asked him if people are so important and people were to ask you to give us something innovative, what would it be? So he said, if I were to go around asking people to tell me the innovation, they would say, give me horses which are faster, which are swifter. But they would not have been able to tell me, give me a motorized engine. You know, creativity is distinct from mediocrity. It is distinct from means and averages. And I think we should all provide an ecosystem in the government for people to think creatively, so that we can have many more Henry Fords who can work with the public and also give them this, you know, thought which does not exist, to be able to think ahead of the times, but for the people, because people cannot envision things. And that is why we have been assigned this great task, you know, to work with the people for to also provide the vision, which people might themselves not be able to think, because people, you know, after all, follow the herd mentality that we so got so used to talking of, like the herd immunity. So I think, you know, our jobs are very, very challenging. And that is the beauty, because you don't get bored. There is no monotony in the jobs. So I hope I've answered.
You're absolutely right in terms of, you know, the need for creativity and, you know, moving away from the mediocrity of it. But I'm going to take something that you said. You talked about technology being an enabler. Shubhendra, has technology been an enabler for musicians? I mean, if you look back, you know, there's a research paper by the University of Iowa and Uma Shankar on a third century amphitheater in Orissa that was built, which to date has the most perfect acoustics. So it's not that technology wasn't apparent in the earlier periods. How do you see technology having enabled, say, the music space or the artistic space? And I'll go on to give you another example of how in the Culture Minister Summit 2 years ago, we used music to show how it could be worked for people with Alzheimer's and dementia. But first, how has it enabled folks like you?
Lovely, Sanjoy. I'll first just say whatever is relevant to this question, and then I would like to take on a point of both Mukhtaji and Dr. Vineji about what they have said. Indeed, for sure, technology has helped, especially in these pandemic times also. We artists, we have become, say, much more savvy technically too, in terms of being able to record, in terms of being able to do your own set designing, you know, because there's no person coming to do all those jobs. So, you know, whether it was sitting at home and doing Facebook Live or recording for YouTube or recording for Teamwork Arts also, we all had to do it sitting at home and we had to hone our own skills. It was just not about playing the music or creating, but also creating the technology within you to to be able to accomplish that. So I think technology did help us immensely. Mugdaji, you pointed out about the left side of the brain and the right side of the brain. You know, as you may be aware, my wife and I, we are running a education program for young children. And through the research that we have seen and done, it is very, very clear that music and arts in general is the key to especially building that creativity in young children. And Vineji spoke about arts education. And I believe that, you know, for a child to be creative, for a child to be able to think along those lines, education starts from day one of the child's entry into this world, or rather even I would say 9 months before it comes. Mother is the first guru. Father is the first Superman. The day the child enters school is the day when we can at least access all of them. And it's so very important to get arts into their sphere of thinking so that that element of creativity, that element of wanting to learn, wanting to create, because music and painting and poetry, that's what is all about creating. And once that thing is put in them in the early years, as we are trying to do, I think then we are set for success. But what is very important, and here I'll quote my own guru, to be strong in your roots. As people growing up here, we need to be strong in our strong classical roots of music, of dance, of theater. And then once those roots are strong enough, then there is nothing that will sway you away from it. There are a lot of things we can learn from other cultures, from traveling around. We can always learn, but we'll be true to who we are. And that for us is a very, very important identity itself. So creativity, I think, stems from a very good education system where the child is exposed to being creative right from a very, very early age. And as we know, the age from 0 to 10 is what is most important for everyone. So,
Shubhendra, let me stop you there for a second and ask you, creativity, yes, we've seen that. We know how important it is for music to be played and how it develops the cognitive process. Tell us about how do you unleash imagination? I mean, you yourself, your son, I mean, who is this incredible pianist and performer, how do you unleash imagination even with those who have access to nothing that will open up their minds? What is that process?
Obviously, it's not a one-day process. It's a process that happens by exposure day in and day out. So when an education system has supports that element of
I think Shubhendra is
a lot more because of that. And once we
Shubhendra, sorry, you froze for a second. So I'm just, you know, while your signal stabilizes, I'm going to go to Dr. Sarasabuddin, then come back to you. Dr. Sarasabuddin, Shubhendra talked about being strong in your roots. Now, we know that one of the most important things is like what Picasso said, you have to know how to paint before you can break out of there. But even in this context, you need to be very clear about your origins, your history, your past, your forefathers. And from there, of course, you can launch out to the moon. And how do you address that? I mean, we, of course, talk about our ancient culture and our ancient heritage. But when you actually look at it within, whether it's in the education system or in the cultural context, that tends to disappear somewhere. So what is it that we need to do to anchor ourselves? Because in today's day, everybody is a migrant. Everybody is traveling from one city to the other city, from one country to the other country. And yes, when you travel to another country, you tend to take much more and hang on to that culture of yours than actually if you travel from one city to the other. So how do we relook at some of the necessity or the necessary issues of rooting ourselves, of knowing about our past and understanding what has been evolved, whether it's mathematics or Shunya or the number zero, etc.
See, we don't take birth and then we don't grow in a vacuum. We of course, we are a part of a society, and the society helps us to grow. In a way, the society provides us our identity. I mean, it's good for Shakespeare to say what is a name, but my name is Vinay, and if somebody spells it as Vijay, I keep on insisting, oh no, it's not J, it's N. I mean, Shakespeare doesn't help me here for that matter. And therefore, whether it is your name or your geographical area that you represent or the language or whatever it is, it's not for no reason that the social scientists switched over from what was described as melting pot theory to a salad bowl theory, where everybody maintains his or her identity intact and still becomes a part of a larger identity. In this case, maybe a global identity, because we are now in an internationalized world for that matter. And therefore, this is bound to happen. But it doesn't mean that you can forget what you are and still move forward, because what you are provides you that energy, that ethos, that particular identity. That is something which even sociologists today, even though people are relishing in all kinds of progressive ideas and nothing wrong about it, but then identity is something which I believe nobody can rubbish. And therefore, whether it is literature, whether it is language, for example, let us take again the example of Shakespeare. Unless and until you understand what exactly are the Shakespearean plays and what kinds of proverbs and all other things were there in those plays, in the dialogues, then only you will be able to understand what is the meaning of Lady Protest Too Much. Otherwise, it will be Greek to you. So you have to understand history, you have to understand language, you have to understand culture. Everything provides you an ensemble to know that particular cultural ethos, cultural moorings, civilizational values, so on and so forth. And therefore, nobody can, I believe, disagree today that identity, your roots, from where you have come world over. I mean, this is not just happening here. Everywhere, back to the roots is the trend today, and sociologists acknowledge it. And nobody believes that there is anything wrong about it, for that matter.
Roger, Dr. Sasbude talked about back to the roots, but I'm going to go a little further and say, have in our history or in world history, has crisis been the root to innovation and creativity and imagination? Look at whether it's in the more recent history of the world wars, where cities were completely bombed asunder and you had a whole new generation. Look at the Spanish flu, which still seems to be haunting us, or smallpox, etc. And of course, look now at what the pandemic has done. Is this again a tipping point and an opportunity to look at, as Dr. Sasbude said, your origins, history, identity, but the possibility of moving ahead with a whole new paradigm?
Yeah. No, I'd agree. I mean, I think the scientific endeavor, you know, is driven by curiosity and that sense that old questions lead to new ones. It's driven by new technology and new techniques. And it's also very driven by problems as well. You know, I was bouncing neutrons to measure ultra thin films, you know, just a molecule or two thick. And you're right, war is actually a big driver for developing technologies, sadly. And so we saw it perhaps most vividly with World War II, with the Manhattan program. But you know, once we develop new technologies, then that can take us into new directions. You know, we were talking about left brain, right brain. I'm not sure I buy into that now, because I've seen a few years ago something called magnetoencephalography, where you're using things called SQUIDs, superconducting quantum interference devices, to pick up the tiny magnetic fields generated by a working brain. And you can see activity all over the brain when people do quite simple things. So I'm a little bit allergic to trying to oversimplify what's happening in the brain. But I suppose the point, so I'd agree with the fact that conflict, and I think climate change is another great crisis, is driving innovation. When it comes to the impact of techniques, I think what's interesting about science is it's very much moving into the world of the intangible now. So in my case, I was investigating the world of, you know, in effect, the atom and molecules and so on. But now we've got things called gravitational wave observatories. We are looking at little ripples in space-time that are giving us a new window of the universe, you know, the most violent things in the universe. And I think with the pandemic, what's interesting is that digital has really rose up and science has become much more collaborative in recent decades. You know, the idea of the lone genius, it's the lone genius is going a bit extinct. So I think digital is bringing people together, together in new ways and leading us into new directions. And I should add that that's one of the reasons I love the Jaipur Literature Festival, is it's such a melting pot of ideas and people and so on. And so there we are, a little gratuitous plug for your wonderful festival.
Well, you came only 2 days, so I hope that it helps you. But I'm going to quickly ask Shubhendra and Mukta and Dr. Sasapathy to give us a very short comments, because I know we only have a few minutes left to end up the session. Mukta, Roger talked about crisis and how that becomes the mother of invention. What comes first? Do you need a problem to solve? Do you have to understand the problem and then find a creative, innovative, imaginative solution? Or can you do that even without the problem at hand? I mean, would the roti maker have arrived if there wasn't every housewife wanting to beat up on their family while they were baling roti? What comes first?
Dan Norman has written a book called The Design of Everyday Things, right? And says that good design is difficult to, you know, differentiate, and bad design is found everywhere, and you can only have bad design. So, you know, in necessity is the mother of invention, because, you know, our faith spoke of war. War is probably a metaphor for, you know, cosm, but we are all at a very, very individual level fighting small battles. Women are in the rural areas continuously fighting battle for the quality of life, to ease the drudgery of their life. So, you know, simple things like how they can peel the dhania, you know, without having too much time. And that is where actually science, technology, creativity, imagination, and innovation comes into being. And, you know, Archimedes is my favorite science for the simple reason. And, you know, it applies also to the government, where we are at the point of, at the cusp of solving the problem, that, you know, with less input, you know, you should be able to provide better outcomes, more output. That is the idea. So that the lever, the concept of the lever, is what we should always keep in our mind when we are trying to do any problem solving. And problem solving needs a multidisciplinary approach. It has to be translational. It is all about people coming together. God has been the prototype of the sign of the first designer, right? He did not even have a brief. But the point is that he created nature and man, flora, fauna, everything was part of this nature. He did not create any silos. It is we who have created independent or different, you know, disciplines or facts. So I think at some stage in life, we must break these silos, break these barriers, and come together as one people to solve the problem of mankind. And I think crisis
is battles
help us do that.
Hold that. So collaboration, Roger's talked about collaboration, Mukta's talked about collaboration, the need to come together, break silos. Shubhendra, very quickly, because I've got a time up notice. Collaboration, how do you see this going forward?
I think that's indeed the key for being able to move forward, for trying to solve anything, because as long as there is a dialogue, as long as people can understand each other, as long as people kind of always work together, I think working together is the footsteps of progress.
Thank you. Dr. Vinay, last comments about innovation and India. Do you see
I think I know. Whether in India or in any other country, I think speed is becoming one of the most decisive factors of our life, public life, personal life, everywhere. and people want results. It is the result orientation which is putting some kind of a pressure on all of us. It's a creative pressure though. But then if you want mass production in a shorter span of time, naturally all kinds of new technologies and innovation, creativity, everything will come into the play. But if you have time and if you have the luxury of having individual treatment to every particular case in your own way, then it had its own beauty as well. And therefore, we have to recognize both. If the situation that demands quicker results and mass production, then perhaps technology and innovation are the only way. But if you have time, then perhaps you can have individual treatment as well, like as it happens with roti maker and our traditional way of preparing Indian bread, for that matter.
Technology and innovation, collaboration is the way forward. Mukta Sinha, Roger Highfield, Dr. Vinay Sasabuddhe, Shubhendra Rao, thank you so much.
Thank you, Vinay, Mukta, Shubhendra, Roger and Sanjoy for such an enlightening conversation. Thank you so much for being part of Jaipur Literature Festival 2021. We'd like to thank our celebration partner, Diageo. And thank you all for watching and being such a great audience. Please stay logged on to continue to watch with us the series of exciting sessions featuring a stellar list of speakers that have been specially curated for you. As you're aware, the cultural sector has been critically impacted by the pandemic, and while we have embraced ourselves to embrace the new normal, we have struggled to ensure that we can continue to bring you a free flow of knowledge and ideas. We would love for you to support us at Teamwork Arts. Any contribution is welcome and would help spread knowledge and ideas seamlessly against all odds. Please tweet using hashtag Jaipur Literature Festival 2021 @ Jaipur Lit Fest. The festival is protected by Dettol. Hope to see you in the next session. Thank you.